The Insight. Insight. The Insitome.
Podcast.
Genetics.
Human.
Archaeology.
Denisovans.
Neanderthals.
Metabolism.
Ancestry.
Where in the world did we come from?
I am.
Unique DNA.
Genome. From Austin,
Texas.
This week, Darwin Day Special. Do gentlemen really prefer blondes?
Really quickly, just want to remind listeners, please subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or Google Play. It really helps us out a lot. Gets the word out about the podcast. And, of course, mention it to your friends. Email them, bug them, pester them, share it on social media. Let's do the introductions first, and then we'll get to what we're talking about.
Yeah, sure. I'm Spencer Wells, founder and CEO of Insitome.
And I am Razib Khan, Director of Scientific Content at Insitome.
And today we are recording this on Darwin Day. And Darwin Day being the day that Charles Darwin was born. So February 12th, 1809, Charles Darwin popped out onto this earth. Best known, of course, for The Origin of Species, in which he described evolution by natural selection. Not the first person to talk about evolution, but the first person to provide a mechanism by which evolution could occur. It was a book that was published in 1859, well on into Darwin's life. So those of you who are concerned about being late bloomers, Darwin was 50 years old when he finally got around to publishing this. But in it, he talked about this concept known as natural selection, which is a mechanism for evolution to occur and for improvements and innovations to happen, biologically speaking. And so, you know, the question is, why do we have eyes? Why do we have big brains? Why do we have the ability to walk upright on two legs and to run and so on? All of these really cool things that we do as a species, or that any species is capable of doing. How did all of those things originate? And so Darwin's theory was, and it's really, you know, Darwin, if you think about the timing, born in 1809, came of age around the time that Queen Victoria first sat on the throne. Victorian age, people are obsessed with competition. And Malthus was writing about populations crashing into the carrying capacity. And so there's an intense competition for resources. And as a result, some individuals are going to win and some are going to lose. And Darwin basically applied that thinking to the natural world. The application of that way of thinking is essentially the concept of natural selection. Some individuals are born, they happen to be born, with characteristics that are better adapted to the world around them. Other individuals happen to be born with characteristics that are not as well adapted to the world around them. And the ones that are better adapted win out, have more offspring, and eventually increase in frequency. And in that way, the organisms as a species adapt over time to the world around them.
Yes.
So that is, in essence, in a nutshell, what the theory of evolution by natural selection is all about.
And let's distinguish natural selection versus adaptation. They're obviously quite related, but adaptation is being driven by natural selection on heritable variation. And Spencer's PhD advisor, actually, I think, was in the 60s or 70s. He had a list of conditions for adaptation, evolutionary adaptation, and you have to have variation of the trait. The trait has to be heritable across generations, that variation. And there has to be differential fitness on that trait. And by fitness, we don't mean being jacked or shredded. By fitness, we mean the number of offspring you have. And so fitness is basically...
evolutionary fitness is basically the extent to which you leave your genes into the next generation. So basically the number of offspring, or the relative number of offspring you have compared to other individuals in the population.
Yeah. When Darwin was writing and thinking, there was, for lack of a better word, proto-Darwinian thought outside of biology as well. Social Darwinism, for example, came out at about the same time.
And, Herbert Spencer.
Yeah, and they actually co-opted, social Darwinists actually co-opted the term Darwinism because of its prestige coming out of the natural sciences. But
And in fact, the concept of descent with modification, which is, you know, another concise way of describing evolution, had been around for a while in linguistics. So William Jones, who noticed that Sanskrit and Hindi and Greek and Latin and English all probably belong to the same family, probably descended from a common ancestor and diverged over time. He wrote about that at the end of the 18th century, so 50 years before, more than 50 years before Darwin published The Origin of Species.
I should have given a nerd alert before that. But so evolutionary ideas, though, I mean, I think what Spencer was getting at, they obviously predate Darwin. So why is Darwin such a big deal on Darwin Day? Why did Darwin make such an impact during his time? Because as Spencer notes, evolutionary ideas were relatively prominent already, including Darwin's grandfather, Erasmus.
Yeah, exactly.
It's because the mechanism. Darwin presented natural selection on heritable variation, which resulted in gradual change over time, allowing for specialization and diversity. It's the origin of species. Why are there millions, tens of millions of species as opposed to one species? Well, specialization. And specialization, you know, you arrive at it through natural selection.
Well, so let's go back to what you were talking about with Lewontin's, you know, set of rules about what you need to have evolution by natural selection. You've got to, at the most basic level, have some way of generating variation. So individuals are not identical to each other. Why is that? It's because mutations happen randomly over time.
Yeah.
So that's the ultimate source of variation. Those mutations can either be neutral. They occur in a part of the genome where they have literally no effect on the organism.
Junk DNA.
Junk DNA, perhaps, or maybe in a gene, but in a third codon position, if you're talking about a protein coding region, so it doesn't affect the actual protein itself.
Or nerd alert, intron. Things.
Or an intron. So, you know, parts of the gene that may not be as important as the parts that determine the eventual protein sequence and structure. So, you know, mutations could be neutral. They could be deleterious. You know, they could knock out a gene that is absolutely critical for survival. And, you know, in that case, often, you know, something will happen during embryogenesis and, you know, there will be, you know, spontaneous abortion or perhaps, you know, may make it full term, but the child has serious problems, congenital illnesses. Or the mutation could be advantageous in some way. And so, you know, the ordering of these in terms of, you know, whether they're neutral, they're deleterious, or they're advantageous, that's really alluding to the concept that selection is going to act on the ones that are either deleterious or advantageous. And so selection is that, you know, that relative level of survival in different categories of these genetic mutation classes.
Yeah. And so, you know, what Spencer just did there is he swept across 100 years of science to start talking about population genetics, right? So when Darwin was writing, population genetics did not exist because genetics did not exist. Although Mendel was working on his bees at the same time, genetics as a field did not really exist.
Well, so have you ever been to Darwin's home?
No, Spencer. Tell us about it.
I have, and it's really cool. You know, you can go into Darwin's study, and you can see all the books that he was reading. And he was reading, famously, you know, everyone who studies evolutionary biology learns about Charles Lyell and all of his books on geology and gradual change through time and so on. Those had an influence on Darwin, but he also had books from people that he never cut the pages on. So going back to the 19th century, when they were printed, the pages had to be cut to open the book and read it. And so he had uncut pages in some of his books. And one of those books was a book from a monk in Austria named Gregor Mendel, describing all of his experiments with peas. Darwin was not a terribly good student. Darwin was kicked out of medical school at the University of Edinburgh for basically not going to class and not doing that well when he did. He was, as he described it, inordinately fond of beetles. He was really into natural history and collecting and partying. He liked to play cards with his friends. And so he eventually was installed at Cambridge University, where he was going to train for a country parsonage. That's what Oxford and Cambridge trained people to do in those days, to be like country preachers in essence. And so, you know, he was never that into math, and he never, as a result, really understood the genetic ramifications of his theory. And in fact, in later editions of The Origin of Species, he talks about something called blending inheritance, which would actually remove variation in the population and make natural selection impossible.
Yeah, so we're jumping here between eras. Obviously, the idea of natural selection is essential, but how it occurs, Darwin didn't really end up at a position that we would recognize as, frankly, correct. So blending inherits every generation, it would remove the variation that natural selection needs as its raw material to operate. So it would undermine the very power of the evolutionary force that Darwin's theory rested upon. And so what do we need to understand? Fast forward about 50 years, the field of genetics is invented, discovered, rediscovered, forwarded in Britain and the United States.
Hardy Weinberg.
Yeah.
Around that time.
And so genetics basically is a model of inheritance where the variation are discrete units. So they don't blend. And so variance does not disappear. And so that allows the variation that natural selection needs to persist.
So we've got Darwin with this theory that ultimately is correct, even though he didn't understand the mechanism. We've got the rediscovery, if you will, of genetics in the early 20th century. And then we have what we call the evolutionary synthesis, which is, you know, the people who came along who started to blend together, you know, the concepts of genetics with the older concepts of evolution, adaptation, natural selection, and so on. And so those are guys like JBS Haldane, Theodosius Dobzhansky,
Ronald Fisher, Sewell Wright,
yeah.
Yeah, and there were a variety of people from you know, widespread disciplines, some people coming out of ornithology. I believe Mayer came out of ornithology. They came together, they fused all these disciplines that were looking at evolutionary process through different windows. And frankly, population genetics was the unifying framework to make sense of all of this. And so as we've been talking, because our background is more in population genetics, obviously that's bled through. We've already started talking about deleterious, etc. These really make sense when you think of genes and mutations as specific units and you understand the algebra of the quantities of the amount of mutation you get and the amount of selection you get and the selection pressures. So when you talk to a geneticist and they are talking about natural selection, they are not thinking so much of physical changes over time. What they are thinking is you have a genome and it's bubbling with mutation in the background. So what is a genome? We now know because of molecular genetics, which happened about 50 years after genetics as such, that the genome is just a string with four letters for the point mutations, for the single nucleotide polymorphism, SNPs. Those SNPs mutate at a given rate. I think with humans, you know, it's 10 to the negative 8, you know, per base per generation, etc. Like there's a specific quantity you can establish. So you have that mutation. As Spencer said, mutations are mostly neutral or they're bad.
Well, so let's stop there and pause because that's actually a really big concept and it didn't just happen on its own. I think if you could rewind back and have a conversation with Ronald Fisher or JBS Haldane or Dobzhansky and you ask them, like, is selection acting on most of this variation that occurs through a mutation? They would say, yeah, probably. And then there was this Japanese scientist named Moto Kimura who came along and he said, well, probably most of the variation is actually neutral and it drifts around in frequency yeah. due to shifts in population size and so on.
Yeah. And so neutral theory, which Spencer is alluding to, is basically a null hypothesis or a baseline that evolutionary geneticists, molecular evolutionists often use. There's a lot of debates still around that, although I feel like they're a lot more amicable now because we have a lot more data. So when you have more data, there's less room to disagree in a more subjective, emotional way because you're just too busy looking at the data. So with neutral theory, you can have a situation, for example, with humans where the population size is not relatively large until recently. And with the power of random genetic drift, which increases as the population size drops, you will have more power of neutrality in terms of like affecting the change in allele frequencies in terms of the variance. Now, if you have a large population, say bacteria or maybe Drosophila, quote unquote fruit fly, selection might be more powerful. So population genetics to a great extent is an exploration of these parameters, selection, drift, migration,
population size.
Yeah, and population size.
A really simple rule of thumb, kind of a, you know, undergraduate takeaway from a population genetics class, is that if S is greater than 1 over N, so the selection coefficient, which is a measure of how strongly selection is acting on the variant, if that's greater than 1 over the population size, then selection is going to be acting. If it's less than that, then drift is probably going to be a little bit more important. So these random fluctuations in allele frequency or SNP frequency from generation to generation. We're not going to go into all the detail on genetics theory, but for those of us who have studied population genetics, I mean, these are some really basic takeaways. Essentially, small populations, which is, you know, as Razib said, how humans lived for most of our history on Earth, small hunter-gatherer groups, fissioning off, spreading around the planet, and so on, probably drift was really important. And more recently, particularly after the Neolithic Revolution, first podcast.
Yeah, I see that.
You know, population size explodes. And so there's 7.6 billion of us. So selection probably a lot more important much more recently.
Yeah. So selection can be affected by population size. It can be affected by change in environment, which obviously has affected humans. Now that we are talking in the language of population genetics and not just standard evolutionary theory, let's go over really quickly the types of selection, right? So deleterious mutations, Spencer's already alluded to, that is impacted by negative selection. So that basically means that selection is acting against the increase in the frequency of that variant. So it's very straightforward. Negative selection is probably ubiquitous. It's, to some extent, a background constraint on any new mutation. We call it, you know, functional constraint, because you don't want to change something that's working correctly, right?
Yeah, and people who aren't particularly interested in the mechanisms of evolution or hardcore population genetics make use of the patterns that result from deleterious selection to find regions of genes that are really important for function. So if you see, you know, a section of the gene that is conserved and is essentially identical between humans and fruit flies and, you know, worms and fish, it's probably, you know, really, really important to the function of that gene.
Yeah, there's only one way you can do it. Operationally, only one way you can do it, and you can't change it. I think like cytochrome is one reason.
Use
it for phylogenetics, so it barely changes. Another type of selection, obviously, is positive selection, which is the opposite of negative selection. It's really straightforward. Increases in the allele frequency over time. So it's a new mutation that happens to be beneficial, which is very rare, but it obviously happens because we see diversity all around us within species and between species. And within positive selection, now with genomics, we can talk about different types. So hard sweep, soft sweep. Hard sweep basically means it's a new mutation rising in frequency really rapidly, recently usually. A soft sweep is something where there's a lot of variation that's in populations, and a new environmental condition or a new context means that some of those mutations are useful, and so you have perhaps multiple different mutations moving up in the background. And this is only relevant because, you know, in our work, in our company, and what we're looking at, it looks like soft sweeps are much more important for human evolution than we had previously understood.
So what's an example from one of our products?
I think the fads. Yeah, the fatty acid synthesis, probably a soft sweep. The variation has probably been there for a long time. So fads, just to refresh, it's the fatty acid synthesis, and it varies by the amount of plant material, usually a plant and animal material you have in your diet. And that's probably varied over time in multiple populations constantly across human history because we're omnivorous, right? And so that variation has been there.
And hard sweep, you know, would be more like lactase.
Yeah.
So single mutation.
In Eurasia,
in northern European populations where, you know, they're pastoralists, they're raising sheep, cattle, goats, they want to drink the milk, rises to very high frequency, very rapidly, you know, largely since the Bronze Age, so in the last 5,000 years. And in some populations in northern Europe, it's nearly at 100%.
Yeah, yeah. And so, you know, just to, like, complete the nerding out on population genetics, I'm going to talk really quickly about balancing selection, and it's really easy to understand. Basically, it's maintaining genetic diversity. It's another way besides neutrality. So one way is, like, for example, on overdominance, the heterozygote's more advantageous, malaria. Google it. Everybody knows about malaria example and sickle cell as a bad side effect. So it's never going to go to 100% frequency. Another issue is you have frequency dependence, and this is really important for disease. Basically, when your immune genetic profile becomes very common, bacteria and other pathogens that reproduce really fast can become extremely fit against it. They can evolve against it.
So a good example of that would be the variation in the human leukocyte antigens, HLA.
Yes.
The most diverse part of the genome. And there are literally hundreds, thousands of different versions of these floating around in human populations. There's a lot of recombination going on, so you actually generate novel variants very rapidly. You're mm-hmm. generating them all the time, basically. And it's kind of an arms race.
Yeah.
So as you said, you know, you've got pathogens that have a very short generation time, and they're evolving really, really rapidly. So you need to have like this amazing defense system to protect against
them. And you need portfolio diversity within the, I mean, if you think on a species level. So it's so diverse that HLA locus that Spencer is talking about, it's pretty famous for having, you can have an HLA profile that's closer to a chimpanzee than your relative because these alleles are so ancient. They never go extinct. And the reason they never go extinct is the rarer they are, the more fit they are, right? And so that's negative frequency dependence, and that maintains diversity.
Yeah, it's really cool. And in fact, some of the HLA alleles seem to have come into the modern human population relatively recently from our cousins, the Neanderthals and the Denisovans. Yeah. So yeah, really, really interesting part of the genome. We should do a show just on HLA, MHC.
Yeah, perhaps we could, you know, have someone else on that we know who is working on a startup related to that.
Colleague, Nathan friend. Pearson.
Yeah, Nathan Pearson. And the last one I just want to mention, because I don't want ecologists to get angry with me, because they are, you know, very like athletic and fit scientists, spatial variants. And Spencer actually just alluded indirectly to something that might be relevant. Eurasian hominids were all, Eurasian and African hominids were distributed across a wide area of the old world. And so they might have had local adaptations to local endemic diseases. And so diversity can be maintained just through spatial variants of a species that has a patchy landscape with like lots of different fitness conditions, right? So let's just move on really quickly, because we've really nerded out to something that might, I don't know, like be more on the minds of the typical listener. So natural versus sexual selection. Spencer, do you think that that's a legit distinction?
I do. And the reason I do is because I was trained in classical evolutionary theory. And, you know, my undergraduate evolution teacher here at the University of Texas is a professor who's still in the department that I'm in, Mark Kirkpatrick. And he did a lot of his early work on sexual selection. Natural selection really affects how you do in some sort of objective sense in the environment around you. So it's the reason why cheetahs were selected to run faster, you know, and running fast allows you to kill prey more efficiently, and that is just better off in the environment. Sexual selection is where certain characteristics have been selected for by mates because they find them attractive. And the reason they find them attractive can be utterly random and have nothing to do with the ultimate, you know, survival skills of the individuals that possess those traits. The best example is the peacock's tail. Females love to mate with peacocks, the male of the species, that have huge tail feathers with lots of colors, and they're really amazing. I mean, everybody's seen a peacock. The hens, the females, don't have those tails. The peahens, you know, no tails at all. So it's basically the females selecting the males that have the big tails. Okay, that's great. If you have a big tail, you're going to have a better opportunity of mating. But the problem is, having a big tail makes it much more likely that you're not going to be able to fly that well. You're not going to be able to run that fast. And some, you know, predators.
The cheetah would say yummy.
Exactly. Exactly. So to me, they're very distinct. There could be some overlap, but, you know, sexual selection is more arbitrary, I would say.
It is. So, and I just before a nerd jumps on my throat about this, cheetahs used to be prevalent in India before they went extinct. Just someone's gonna say, but they're in Africa. No, they're in India. There's still some Persian cheetahs. Google it. In any case, I think I am a skeptic of making the distinction. I understand where Spencer is coming from, but I tend to think of things more on the genomic level. And on the genomic level, it's much more difficult. I mean, selection to me is selection, whether it's natural or sexual. And with sexual selection, we do have to say there is a handicap principle. There are ideas that sexual selection is acting on genetic fitness.
And in fact, you know, you talk about the handicap principle. That's actually really important, because the thinking there is that if you select for things that are actually deleterious in the environment, you've got to have really good genes overall to kind of make up for that handicap. And so it's a way of, you know, usually it's females choosing males that are likely to pass on really good genes to their offspring.
So the theory, and it's become much, and the handicap principle was pioneered by Amitai Zahavi, I think is how you pronounce it, in the 1970s, 60s, maybe a little earlier. And I know that Richard Dawkins, I think it was in The Selfish Gene, I think he expressed a lot of skepticism about it. This is one issue where he has changed his mind, and he thinks there's a lot more to the handicap principle than he did in the past. And now there are researchers looking at it quantitatively and now genomically. The evidence empirically has been a little bit mixed. I don't know the literature too well, but there's something there.
There is something there, but you know, you bring up this issue with genomic studies. You're coming at it from the point of view of a genomicist or geneticist. And, you know, as I said, I started off this discussion saying that I was trained in more of a classical evolutionary sense. Evolutionary biologists think in terms of the phenotype, and selection is acting on a phenotype. But of course, at the genomic level, it's very hard to tell what, you know, form of selection is acting on any given phenotype that's associated with the genotype. It could be natural selection. It could be sexual selection.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is like the perspective that you come from. I was not trained in that way at all. I was actually an undergraduate biochemistry major, and I went more through molecular evolution, molecular genetics. Well,
and I did too. I mean, I basically had a double major in biology and chemistry, but the reason I got interested in population genetics was from that evolutionary perspective rather than as a geneticist first.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, I don't really think we're that different, but just point of emphasis here, I'm a little more skeptical, partly because I think it confuses people, because sexual selection is straight up confusing, right?
And what would an example of sexual selection in humans be? I mean, people perhaps don't remember that Darwin's second most famous book, so, you know, after Origin of Species, he wrote books on earthworms and domestication and all sorts of stuff that people don't really get. But basically, he was still thinking about, like, can we find evidence for adaptation and selection and so on and evolution in the natural world? And then he publishes this blockbuster called The Descent of Man, where he, you know, in The Origin of Species, he kind of danced around it. And his wife, of course, is religious, and there's all sorts of, like, backstory to this. I'm not going to go into that. But, you know, he takes it on, head on, in Descent of Man, published in, I believe, 1872. And the subtitle of Descent of Man is in and Selection in Relation to Sex. And so Darwin, you know, asks in that book, okay, you know, we all descend from a common source and we've moved around, but why are we so variable phenotypically? And he has a little quote in the book that I will, you know, I use in teaching and I use it in lectures sometimes. He says, you know, we have to be aware that, like, we're really good at picking up on subtle differences in facial appearance, for instance, skin color, nose shape, and so on. And those probably play a role in how we choose mates. And so, you know, physical features, whether it's hair color, eye color, whatever it might be, that probably is subject to a certain extent to sexual selection.
Mm-hmm. So there's two different points that I would make here. First of all, there's some things that are obviously common human universals. So sexual dimorphism, the average human male is somewhat bigger than the average human female. That is not arbitrary. There are some species, like monogamous gibbons, I believe, where there's no size difference. And there are other species that are much more extreme, like gorillas.
And so that is correlated with the extent to which you are
sexually selected.
And, you know, also whether you have multiple mates.
Yeah, polygamy. So basically, sexual selection in polygamous organisms is very strong because a few males. So elephant seals are probably the classic case.
Yeah, they're huge.
Yeah, they're huge. And there's one male elephant seal might be responsible for 80% of the offspring on the beach.
Yeah, the Genghis Khan of
elephant seals. And that's just every generation, right? So there's this universal stuff where you see, like, men tend to be, like, a little more robust. Women have big eyes, a little more pedomorphic features, et cetera, et cetera. There's a lot of theories about that. Then you have the second issue. I first encountered this, I think, in Jared Diamond's Third Chimpanzee. This was written in the late 80s before really a lot of genetics on humans. And what the way Diamond tells it, and I believe it's accurate, is that basically racial differences in phenotype could be due to sexual selection. So blonde hair or dark skin or curly hair or straight hair, these sorts of things might be due to sexual selection. So this is about, like, local differences. And we don't need to get into it, but, I mean, there's all sorts of models that can actually explain this from evolutionary genetic pop gen perspective. Whether it's true or not, that's a different issue.
And we've had this discussion. I mean, I've speculated on, you know, why there is so much variation in, say, hair color and eye color in Western Eurasian populations and not so much in East Asian, Native American, Sub-Saharan African populations. Could sexual selection have played a role in that? We don't know. I mean, it's all just so stories. You can invent a story for any of these things. But, you know, it might have played a role.
It might have. So I would say I'm more of a skeptic, but the reality is we don't know so much about this. And so this podcast is about selection, probably with a focus, obviously with a focus on humans. We both tend to focus on humans in our own work and our company. But there's so much about humans and selection that we don't know. We just know that it happens. So you look at the genome of a human.
I was about to say, so let's pop open the hood.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
How do you actually go about, mechanically speaking, you know, detecting selection at the genomic level?
It's complicated, sort of, although it's a lot less complicated because you have computers and you have whole genome sequences. So with lactase persistence, lactose tolerance, which is the classical case of natural selection that I think everyone can agree, we have really strong signature of selection in the genome. We have a good cultural evolution story, right? Humans shifted to agropastoralism, milk, very, very nutritional, and now they can digest the milk sugar, which is a third of the calories. So we have...
And so, you know, the way I explain to, you know, general audiences, like how we detect this at the genomic level is I say, okay, you've got this thing called recombination that's going on every generation that is shuffling up the chromosomes. And based on the population history, long-term population size of, you know, any given group, you've got some kind of background level of the lengths of segments of the genome that are shared in common. So the level of what we call linkage disequilibrium. And the way to understand that is to think about, okay, if you've got beaded necklaces with different colored beads, you've got this kind of random background pattern. And imagine that suddenly, as you're scanning down this beaded necklace in one population, you find a segment of beads that's carried by essentially everybody in the population, or at least a huge number, far more than you would expect by chance. If this were true fashion, like jewelry, you would say, well, you know, there was a fad and everybody decided they really wanted to have that on their necklace. That's not what happens at the genetic level. What happens is there's been selection for something in that segment of the genome. It's been driven to higher frequency relatively recently.
Yes.
And it's had hitchhiking of surrounding variants. Yep. Attached to that segment of DNA. And that's what you're able to see in the genome.
Yeah. So with lactase persistence, it's a gene called LCD. We know a lot about it. Over 10 years ago, the most primitive, and I mean primitive, like not that many markers, genomic methods detected this huge long segment that seemed exactly identical all across many Northern Europeans, and it's strongly correlated with a mutation at a position that allows humans to digest milk sugar as adults, lactose. And with ancient DNA, we know it's very recent. It's not present. This mutation is not present very much in Europeans before 5,000 years ago at all. So we know it's really recent from ancient DNA, but we also knew from statistical tests by looking at the length of that segment. And that segment is probably from one person that lived in Eurasia over 5,000 years ago. And that was very, very beneficial. And so it just blew up into the whole genome. So you have like 80% of the people in, say, Denmark, 80 to 90%. Perhaps more, I mean, I haven't looked at the last statistics, carry that segment from that individual. This is
which is
a hard
kind of cool.
Yeah.
You know, this is literally a segment of genome that comes down to you if you carry that, you know, lactase persistence variant from one person who likely lived in the Bronze Age, you know, somewhere in the steppes of Eastern Europe or, you know, possibly in Central Europe. But one person.
And we know that the same segment is found in northern Pakistan. So it's found in Pakistan, Northern
India.
Due to
migrations, you know.
Yeah, probably Indo-European migrations, which we've talked
another about. Another podcast.
We've talked about previous podcasts. But so so this segment is a classic hard sweep. It's a new mutation wasn't found in the human population, and it like swept up to frequency really, really fast, right? So this is like the classic case of what we understand. There's other things we don't understand. So to make it concrete, we were talking about sexual selection and pigmentation. All bets are off in terms of understanding what's going on in Eurasia. There's a lot of evolutionary change in these pigmentation genes over the last 10,000 years. We knew this partly from genetic tests looking at these long segments, right? So SLC24A5 is a gene, just throw that out there, that's really common in West Eurasians. We knew that there was a recent sweep. When we look at the ancient DNA in Western Europe, it just does not exist. For Mesolithic hunter-gatherers. It shows up with the farmers. Now,
and so what does that mean?
You know, so one issue is I'm not sure if it means that they were extremely dark-skinned. They might have had different mutations. That's one issue. We don't know for sure. But it seems highly likely, looking at the suite of various genes correlated with light skin and the fact that they're all being selected in Europe, because other tests that use modern populations, so they're still being selected. In Britain, they're still being swept to frequency in the last couple of thousand years. So Europeans are getting paler. Why? Right? And so it could be like, could it be natural selection?
Vitamin D, which has always been the story.
Yeah. So the vitamin D story, and I can tell you because I wrote like a commentary paper like years ago about this. The vitamin D story is really straightforward insofar as you have a system where you have farmers moving into Northern Europe. They don't have very much sunshine, so they need to synthesize vitamin D with their skin. And another issue is they eat a really monotonous diet that's low in protein compared to hunter-gatherers. So why are Inuit people of the Canadian Arctic not quite as pink as Europeans? Well, one hypothesis is they eat a lot of marine organisms that's rich in vitamin D. So if the European...
So they don't have to be as light-colored.
So if the European hunter-gatherers were consuming a lot of marine organisms, then they would get the vitamin D from their food. Now, you have these farmers that show up. They're at really, really high latitudes. Europe's extremely high latitude for, you know, agriculture, partly because... You know, Gulf Stream, and also it's on the west coast of a climate.
The reason why palm trees grow in Cornwall is we always say,
Yeah.
So you've got this ocean current that's washing up out of, you know, tropical kind of Gulf of Mexico area, east coast of the U.S. It washes off the east coast of Greenland, and then it starts to come back down around the U.K., but it brings all this warm water up from the tropics to a place, to a latitude where it really shouldn't be, and it artificially makes the climate a little bit warmer.
Yeah, and so you have this situation where you have this one story, but then you have another story, which, Spencer, which I think you can talk about a little.
Remind me which story.
The sexual selection story.
Oh, well, listen, I don't know if sexual selection has played a role in skin color.
But
I really don't.
Some people think
Yeah, I mean, it's possible. It's entirely possible. You know, you were talking about possible selection for juvenile features in human females, certainly in some populations. It's possible that, you know, given that light hair, light skin, light eyes, and so on are typically associated with, you know, being younger, being youthful, that there could have been selection on that. I don't know. To me, that's a just-so story.
And this is what we're getting at. There obviously has been selection, but we don't know what's driving it. And it's not just in Europeans. So with light skin, with the loci like correlated with pigmentation, we see selection signatures in Eastern Asia as well, relatively recently. And now there's been a fair amount of work in Africa. And, you know, as in your documentary, Journey of Man, the Khoisan people, the Bushmen, they do not have very dark skin.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, I would say probably, you know, the very dark skin that you see in Bantu-speaking peoples in Western, Central, Southeastern Africa today, originated in West Central Africa around the Bight of Benin. The dark skin you see in Australian Aborigines, the dark skin you see in most New Guineans, I mean, that could be an adaptation to living in a very tropical part of the world where the sun intensity is super high. And, you know, there was probably skin color variation within Africa before modern humans ever left. There's a new paper that Sarah Tishkoff's group just published.
The Crawford paper. So to review on that paper, we've been talking about, I mean, I can tell you the pigmentation loci just off the top of my head, SLC24A5, SLC45A2, OCA2, HERC2. There's like half
these
a dozen.
Are going to be on the quiz, by the way.
No, but I mean, seriously, like there's less than 10. And the reason that there's less than 10 is because there's so much study of European populations, which frankly, they don't vary that much, right? So what the Tishkoff group did is great is they have a huge sample set from Africa. And Africans do vary in complexion. Even in Nigeria, for example, the Bight of Benin area, there are people like Igbo people that are relatively light-skinned, and they have no detectable Eurasian ancestry, any exogenous ancestry. So you have variation within African populations. And, you know, my friend Skip Gates has always asked me, like, well, were the ancestral humans black? And I'm like, well, we don't know for sure. But, I mean, the reality is they were probably varied. Like, we vary today. I mean, for Neanderthals, we see that their pigmentation loci also vary by population. So we don't know if Neanderthals, I mean, I'm highly skeptical of the idea that they all looked the same. I think Neanderthals also varied. Humans are a phenotypically varied population, and sometimes they can be very surprising. For example, in Melanesia and among the central Australian Aborigines, there are people with blonde hair, and it tends to have the same correlation in women and children that you see in Europeans.
Yeah, so Melanesian people's separate mutation that produces the same phenotypes of blonde hair, work done by Carlos Bustamante and his team at Stanford. Let's talk a little bit, and you alluded to this but didn't actually name it, the idea that, you know, you could be selecting for something and there's other stuff that happens, a concept called pleiotropy.
Yeah, pleiotropy is you have a gene. So a gene, in a classical sense, like we try to imagine, okay, gene produces protein, protein does something, blah, blah, blah. The reality is we have less than 20,000 genes in the human genome. A lot of genes do a lot of different things. So you basically push into something here, and then there's all these other responses, correlated responses, right?
And you know, I think that for people who haven't studied the details of evolution and population genetics in particular, I think there's this notion that evolution acts to create a global maximum in some way. And in fact, evolution tinkers and it creates local maxima. So whatever's going to get the job done and allow you to survive and reproduce, that's what's going to be selected for.
Yeah. And it's hill climbing, random hill climbing algorithm. It's exploring the space. It's doing all these random things. It's iterating. Anyone in the startup world, evolution's all about iteration, right? So the metaphors abound. And so when you have pleiotropy, you can have really strong selection on one thing, and then it produces all these correlated responses. And if it's the same cluster of genes that do, you know, paired things, for example, paired traits, you can have a situation where selecting for trait A always results in the same change in trait B. which from the perspective of the scientist can be really confusing. Genomically, it can be quote-unquote relatively easy to understand, but actually to understand what's going on, you need to be, say, a fruit fly geneticist who can actually control the conditions very, very well. When you're talking about humans, you don't know. So, for example, moving on from pigmentation, the really straight, thick hair that's common in Northeast Asians is due to a relatively, I mean, new as in maybe last glacial maximum, 20, 30,000 years-ish mutation that's increased in frequency really rapidly in Northeast Asia and to a lesser extent the New World, EDAR, right? And that gene is a development, it's like a master development gene, which means that it doesn't just do two things, it does many, many, many things.
And that's correlated with all sorts of characteristics, shovel-shaped incisors.
Which are also found in Neanderthals.
Yeah.
So going, you know, like kind of bringing these various different things together, we don't know what's going on, and shovel-shaped incisors are present in Neanderthals, and they're present in East Asians and American Indians, Native American people. This could be like, you know, segregating variation. This could be like soft selection. This could be something that's just part of the hominid evolutionary genetic toolkit. A lot of these things that we think as special, distinct, and unique might just be continuous reinventions of the same general theme. And from the geneticist perspective, we have the whole genome. We have a lot of samples from a lot of different populations now. There's a lot we can generate statistics with, but what can you do with a statistic? This is actually what other types of scholars need to get into, like cultural evolution, archaeologists, anthropologists. We don't have a good explanation. There's a lot of selection, it looks like. And, you know, I do want to like allude to this. There's a debate. We were talking about neutral theory. Is it mostly random? Is the variation due to a lot of selection? As I said, in the 1970s, it was very acrimonious between Motu Kimura and John Gillespie, who was at UC Davis, where, you know, I went study at grad school for a while. Today, I don't think there's any acrimony. It's just looking at the data. And it depends on what species you're in. There's some species where there's a lot of selection. They have huge census sizes. So look at like maize, you know, corn, some of these domesticates. And then you have humans where there's a lot of debate. And so Ryan Hernandez's group at UCSF in San Francisco, they talk about the importance of negative selection and background selection. And that's not positive selection, obviously, but then you have like other groups like my friend Andy Kern or David Inard, who's still in Dmitry Petrov's lab. They talk about how there's ubiquitous positive selection. And that's because we have all this data, and how you look at the data and how you do the calculation, it's not all cut and dried right now. It's a process. It's a process that I think is converging on consensus results. And I know some of these people personally, and I can tell you there's no beef there. You know, they have the data, they're working, they're stepping through it. We will understand the map of selection in the genome, which started, I believe, the modern era, probably Benjamin Voigt's paper in 2006 out of Jonathan Pritchard's lab.
Yeah, so this is all very new. The technologies and the statistical techniques for detecting selection and to have enough data to be able to detect it, all very, very new. But it's a really, really important question because, you know, as I talk about sometimes, you know, when I'm discussing selection human genome in the concept or context of human migration patterns, you know, most of our early work studying how humans moved around the world and so on, the assumption is that genes are just these passive passengers that are coming along and mutating randomly, and they produce patterns that allow us to infer the migratory paths. But of course, they're also adapting and they're allowing us to live in different environments. And so to me, that's really the exciting part. That's the functional part, the how and the why of evolution, not just the who, where, and the when. So to wrap it up, and this is something that I'm asked all the time in interviews, so I'm going to ask you, put you on the spot here.
Thanks,
Spencer. Are humans still evolving? Are we still subject to selection even today?
I mean, this is not a put on the spot. Like, I mean, I would bet my son's life that we're still evolving. I'm so confident.
Okay, so we're still evolving. But the question is, you know, what people mean by that is, well, since we developed agriculture and now we've got modern medicine and blah, people live to like 150 million years old and blah, compared to, you know, how long they lived a few years ago, when, you know, nature read in tooth and claw and all this stuff that we imagine about hunter-gatherer lives. Surely there's been a relaxation in selection. Is there still selection going on in humans?
Yeah, so I think there's two ways to think about it. On the most abstract level, going back to Lewontin's conditions, is there heritable variation? Yeah, there is. Is there variation in fitness? Yeah, I have three children. You have two. You know,
is that and I have not passed on my Y chromosome.
And yeah,
my brother hasn't either. So I have, we didn't pass on our particular sublineage of R1B. You have passed on your
R1A. Twice. And also, like, you know, is are the two correlated with them? You know, this heritable variation and the fitness differences, are they correlated? Like, this is like a little more confused. Like, who knows? So, for example, I think that there's evidence, say, with height, that maybe like smaller women have traditionally had like a higher fitness. So I don't, you know, there's stuff you can say about that. This is like a priori. This is the theory. And I think, yes, like probably, right? But there's another way you can look at it, which I think of it from an embryological perspective. Humans have a very high miscarriage rate. Right, like about on the order of 50%. It depends on who you talk to.
Yeah, so there's, you know, selection in utero.
There's a lot of in utero selection. So if we save people's lives that have genetic congenital defects and they reproduce and they can because we can make, you know, we can save their life. If they're passing on these mutations, who's to say? I mean, I strongly suspect that like the number of mutations you have is going to affect your rate of like how many viable pregnancies you have. And so on the next generation, it could still be filtered out that way. So I think like that's one thing that people don't realize. Selection is happening before the ninth month a lot. I think Rajiv McCoy, I think he's a postdoc at University of Washington. He's shown some evidence that there's a lot of like weird balancing selection going on correlated with miscarriage. I mean, you guys can Google it if you're curious. But yes, definitely selection is going on.
And there was a paper published a couple of years ago looking at selection in the last couple of thousand years in the British population.
SDS statistic.
Yeah, and Brits are getting taller.
They're getting taller. I think they're getting lighter. Their skull shapes are changing. So, yeah, this is
where like, okay, you've got a pattern that you can see in the data. What's the phenotypic reason for that? Like, what mode of selection? And this gets back to that argument about like sexual selection versus natural selection and trying to figure out, you know, what is the cause of that change that you're seeing?
Yeah, I mean, what I would say is like I'm 100% sure selection is happening. I don't know what's happening.
Okay, well, we'll leave it there. Selection, really fascinating topic, really important, obviously, to the understanding of evolution. It has produced all of the really important traits that distinguish any creature on Earth. It didn't all happen randomly.
Yeah, yeah.
No, but the reason we have an opposable thumb, for instance.
And yeah,
we
have, that's, you know, fair. That's fair.
Eyesight, and we can see the colors we can see and so on. That's all due to selection. So selection has produced, you know, all the things that matter the most, I think.
We have a morphological bias. We didn't even get into intergenomic selection. Like, selection is huge. We just talked
we
about
can revisit that.
We can revisit that. All right. So I guess like that's that for this week. Spencer and I are going to be trying to explain selection to you through our company, just so you know. This is not just abstract for us. It's very important in terms of science communication and understanding what genes mean to us as human beings.
You can actually see the effects of selection on the traits that you carry through some of the Insitome products. So check it out on the website, insito.me.
All right.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
For more information about Insitome, our podcasts, and our genetic products, check out our website at insito.me. That's insito.me.